do that.
Hear nothing, see nothing, say nothing. We're back at it.
Yeah, I feel good.
Talking about, what are we talking about?
I want to talk about gentrification.
Oh, I was going to mention this great movie I watched.
All right, let's not talk about gentrification. Let's talk about your movie.
All right, let's talk about gentrification.
No, too late. Let's talk about your movie. Right. We'll go back to gentrification.
All right.
It's coming.
It is coming. You can't stop
There's
it.
There's nothing you can do. But tell us about this movie.
The topic's coming or the gentrification? You can feel something.
Both.
Okay. I watched this movie. I will hear random movie recommendations now because of all these free trials that I'm on.
Sure.
Fucking Amazon Prime, Hulu. Now there's one that IMDb made, but I forgot what it's called. It's called like
a streaming service.
Yeah, yeah. They have a. It's called like Hive Stop or something. I don't know. No.
Weird.
No. It's called a Free Ride. Because I started singing.
Is it free?
Slow Ride. When I saw that.
Is there a song called Free Ride?
No.
Sure, there is.
There might be free Ballin' or whatever.
Free
Tom Petty.
Free Falling.
Oh, okay.
There's Free Falling. I swear to God, like, I don't know. Anyway.
Anyways. Free. It caught my eye when it said Free Ride, and it's sure. I think it's just It seemed weird. It seemed like there's all movies on there, except they have ads in them. So it's like watching a movie on old TV.
Yeah.
But anyways, this movie, Kumare, guys.
All right, the movie is called Kumare.
Yeah.
How do you spell that?
Kumare.
Okay, what does that mean?
So the movie is, you're going to love this, Bill, because I know how much you love religious. It's pretty much, it's kind of the same feel to it. It's how, you know how there's always the next big spiritual thing in America, you know, like, oh, now we're all going to, you know, do chants, and now we're all going to do yoga, and now we're all going to do the, you know. So this guy who is Indian, but he's Americanized. So he like.
So he's an American Indian.
Yeah.
Oh. Oh, my God.
Can we talk about gentrification?
No. All right, continue.
Anyways.
We're talking about your movie.
He's like doesn't have, you know, a foreign accent. He's gone to, you know, he's well raised and educated in the American culture, but he knows all about his Indian culture.
Sure.
And he's like, dude, all these fucking like yoga places and like chant places are popping up with all these like drunk ass white girls who, you know, dance naked and like on acid in a desert or some shit. He's like, I wonder what the fuck is wrong with these people. And basically, because what he was saying is like, you know, he remembers when his grandmother used to do her Hindi prayers at night and like he said he felt such a powerful presence when he would be there with her. And he's like, what differentiates her from these people? So what he did was for like 4 years, he had hair like as long as like me or Zach. And then he grew it down to like his waist, grew a long ass beard down to his waist, gave himself the name Kumare Guru, and traveled the U.S. in this documentary with this fake guru thing with the, and now he's like pretending an Indian accent and he like fooled all these fucking people into like basically following his cult.
Okay,
so
what was his cult? What was he?
It's the Kumare cult. Like it's the, and it's, I don't know. It's just really fun. He like, he goes to
Sharon Tate's house.
May she rest in peace.
Oh, garbage dump. Oh, garbage dump. Buddy, buddy, buddy.
Is anyone going to know
what garbage dump is?
Yeah. Well, we've talked about it before, but I feel like that was really subtle.
If you're not a fan.
It's a Charles Manson reference, everybody.
Right. One of his greats. Along with Sharon Tate.
Yeah.
Oh.
Well, no, it's
played
it's,
her like a fiddle.
it really is.
I don't know. I don't feel good about that.
Can we edit that? Yeah. Can we edit that in post?
I feel like
we shouldn't make light of murder.
I think like the many times that I've said bad things, you have to justify it somehow. Yeah. Very stumblingly.
Yeah, we're keeping the balance. Yeah, yeah. But, yeah. We say off-color things for once.
Yeah. Right. But, you want me to even it out with something, you know?
Yeah, will you say something really
something
innocent?
Yeah.
Something benign?
Something benign.
Can you do that?
You're struggling with it.
Are you capable?
Dude, it only comes natural to me. I don't know how to, like, force it out. Like, you know, like, you know, really, I'm not even kidding. Like, I can't think of anything.
Come on, what would Kumare Guru say?
Can I continue my description of the movie?
Yes.
Because while I think of something benign, yeah. No, well, no, he would like, it's just funny because he goes from city to city and he's like trying to take it one step further. And the funny thing was the way I like got recommended this movie is because you know how like everybody's been talking about like the whole Harvey Weinstein thing and everything and how like being in a powerful position. And he's like being like, dude, I feel fucked up because I'm this like Americanized Indian guy who just got out of college and had nothing to do, so I'm fucking with these people. But all these dumbass, like, wannabe yoga white broads are wanting to fuck me. Like, I have total control. Like, he's shown how, like, being in that fake position, like, everybody is wanting to fuck him. That the whole thing. And then the other thing is, too, like, the funny thing...
What you're saying is I should start pretending to be a cult leader?
Yes.
Yeah. I mean, if...
How
I'm saying how the Orwells need to be cult leaders.
Oh, God. How different is pretending to be a cult leader and actually being a cult leader?
Well, no, because I think, like, the whole yoga craze, it's probably more believable and more rational to follow something that's rooted in Hindi culture than like
sure
like there's gods some, gods from space, you know,
there's a level of
Jesus
legitimacy.
Is born in Utah, you know.
I like that.
Mormonism is a real religion. Yeah, exactly. It's no longer a cult.
It's funny how he keeps taking out a level like
further
because like
he'll have sex with two of these women tonight.
He goes from like, okay, these women are getting close, I need to move to the next city. So he goes to the next city, and then like the next city he's like doing like how there's certain chants and certain like stretches that you do, and he's literally just doing, do you guys remember in Bill and Ted when they do the air guitar thing?
Yeah.
He's doing that. And he's like, this is what we call the, blah, 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 you know, like something in Indian.
Yeah.
And then they translate the Indian, and he's saying like, literally, this is what we call the egg throwing at babies or something. But because he's saying it in Indian, they're like, oh, he's our master, you know, like.
Sure.
And they're doing the fucking air guitar. Like, I don't know. I haven't finished it, but it's pretty interesting.
Okay.
I still think that there's value in yoga and in the, you know.
That was a really benign thing.
Yeah, there we go.
You still think there's value in yoga?
Yeah,
that's pretty benign. Good.
Yeah, I'd say that's.
I thought seems benign. Benign. Doesn't benign mean fucked up?
No, benign is
benign
like.
Benign is like good intentioned.
Yeah.
Oh my God! And that's why this whole time when you said say something benign, I'm you're telling me.
No, thank God you couldn't think of anything.
No, I thought you meant say something fucked up, and that's why I said no. It only comes naturally.
Oh my God!
Because I can't like.
Got you.
Oh my God! I need to expand my vocabulary.
Well, that's what we're
on
here
our
for.
Next episode. Yeah. Hooked on phonics.
That's right. The word of the day. Oh man. I struggle with reading, so I can relate. Anyway, this reminds me. What? Well, no, I was on the phone with a coworker, and like I was like, here, let me read you the email, and I started reading like, hi, Bill. I hope and I was on the phone for like 10 minutes. So I was like, you know, I'm just gonna forward you this email. Like, let's spare me the embarrassment of reading out loud, which. Reminds me of gentrification.
Why?
Well, it doesn't, but that was a nice transition, right?
Yeah, definitely.
Yeah, smooth.
Okay,
seamless.
So about gentrification,
so,
and I hand the mic to Bill.
That's right. So I have a friend who their rent is going up and they can no longer afford their apartment, and so they're in need of a new apartment, and I recommended they move to Bilson, where I live. It's predominantly a Latino neighborhood in Chicago, for our listeners out there, across the pond, wherever you may be. It's a Latino neighborhood, and I say, come to Pilsen. Rent is cheap, and the food is great,
and you get your house broken into.
And, well, once.
Sorry.
Yeah, that should happen
sorry,
to
man.
Anyway.
Right. And she's like, no, I can't move there. I don't want to be a part of gentrification. And I said, like, that's the stupidest fucking thing I've ever heard. Like... I don't know.
Why? What is? Well, is she white?
She's white,
but it's how not.
Dude, all that
segregating
shit.
Neighborhoods is not like the solution to gentrification.
No, that's like kind of like segregated countries, you know, or segregated fucking like racist groups and shit. You don't like you want to be like accepting, right? Yeah.
It's the problem with gentrification is it with developers. It's not the people per se who are moving into neighborhoods. It has to do with developers buying up land and building like expensive housing.
Yeah.
Right. Which in turn raises costs
everywhere. Yeah, and people can, and she's being pushed out of her neighborhood because of rising rent prices. Arguably,
right.
This in the same way gentrification pushes people right. out.
Yeah.
So
she has to live on that land,
and she is causing it when she's actually being victimized by it,
right?
Or possibly victimized. I don't know where she lives.
She's already part of it, basically. But, to me, it's kind of the same argument as trying to be vegan living in an urban environment,
like.
Because
yeah, please explain that.
Okay, well, can you? How do you wear? How can you not go around? Like you'd have to be naked everywhere. Is there anything that has absolutely no animal products on it? Is that possible?
I think so. Yeah, that's what being vegan is all about.
Oh, polyester, completely synthetic.
Is there polyester boots or shoes?
Yeah.
Is there? Can you drive a car?
I don't know about that, but in an urban center, you don't have to drive a car.
I guess maybe I always generalize the extremists of every group.
Sure.
Because that's what represents. So it's sort of like, you know, that type of person would be like, well, where do I buy groceries? Are they friendly about what I believe in? You know,
dude, I live in Logan Square. There's like 10 places you can buy vegan groceries.
Yeah. Yeah. But the other, dude, you know what? That's a great fucking segue because I was listening to this other guy. Dude, no, seriously. All right. This is fucking interesting as fuck because I was listening to this guy. He's a doctor named Gad Sad. Okay.
Aww. All right.
He's cool as fuck. So what he does is he's half like psychology study, marketing research. So what he does is,
people are the devil.
What?
They basically figure out how to fool people into buying products.
It's not so much fooling, but they do the research, and then the people who buy their shit are the ones who fool. So they're sort of like the ones who do the studies. And what he was saying is like, what's crazy is, back to my personal philism Taoism of balance yin and yang, the most successful businesses are the ones who are based on cognitive and emotional. So if you and that's why every fucking like we sell vegan tacos or vegan ice cream or vegan pizza, like those places don't fucking last because there isn't a huge demand for that everywhere, you know, like that's strictly like emotion.
Well,
you need a balance.
Yeah, and they're more niche places, although the Chicago Diner off of Milwaukee has been there since the 80s and it's a completely vegan menu.
Completely
vegetarian. They don't serve meat there. I guess maybe it's not completely vegan, but
but there's probably some aspect of like business too. Like I don't know.
Well, it's the way they bill themselves. Is you actually you wouldn't know that.
Yeah,
they don't they don't like.
It's not called like vegan food.
Yeah,
town.
They don't like heavily highlight the fact that they're a vegetarian place.
And plus, if they probably have an expanded like menu. You know, I'm just going off of what I know. You go into places that are like, for example, I went to a vegan ice cream place. There's like fucking five flavors. It's like, okay, I'll eat something out of the curb, you know.
Some place that like, I can't remember the name. Fuck, it's going to bug
McDonald's.
Me.
McDonald's.
They're a chain store. No, not McDonald's. Does McDonald's even have anything that would be considered vegetarian besides their meat?
Well, that's kind of funny about McDonald's because they're completely cognitive. Like, we just want as much money as possible.
Yeah, but they're not doing very well.
I don't know.
At least in recent days, they're not doing great.
Well, wage costs are going up. And
until they fucking disappear.
People are eating less McDonald's.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So, hang on. Your argument.
Native foods.
What was Dr. Sad saying?
Oh, well, he was saying...
is he a doctor? Did I just make him a doctor?
Yeah, no, he is a doctor. I forgot how he segued to it. You were talking about...
Gentrification.
Gentrification.
Vegans.
And he said it was a great transition.
Yeah. I don't know how the fuck that's a great segue.
All right, so...
The other thing he was... something that I found that was interesting was that people naturally look for the negative. like naturally. Like
I believe I would 100% believe
because
that.
He was saying like they do. This is like some of the studies he does where he was doing like they had like the same group of people, like say 20 of us and our friends, right? He gave a burger to this group in say I don't know January of this is a 90% fat-free burger, and you guys ate it. You did a review of it, and then 4 months down the line, they called them back, and they brought them back in, and they're like, "This is a 10% fat burger," and everybody reviewed the fat, like it was the same fucking burger.
Sure,
but because they heard there's fat instead of fat-free, like, which
yeah,
I think
that makes sense. Yeah, which I could get that.
Well, no, but I think I segued. What the fuck was I? I'm trying.
Roll the tape back.
God damn it. Well, no.
Gentrification.
I was saying how.
Sad.
Yeah, I was saying how, like, you know, you can't fucking base everything one way or the other. Like, you can't do it all business, like, because then people are going to see how you're fucking people over just for money. And then you can't do everything emotionally because then it doesn't last. And when people who, like, think about this, like, gentrification thing, they're like, oh, I want it to be like the old neighborhood. Well, it's never going to fucking be that. It was the old neighborhood in that time. In that like era yeah, with those sure. people,
but there also but there are also real aspects of gentrification that need to be addressed. But like I was saying, they're not necessarily to do with the people who move to these neighborhoods.
Right,
and it's developers.
So this person who did not want to be a part of the battering ram of gentrification and moved down to my neck of the woods said that I don't, you know, mom and pop shops are closing.
Yeah. Those are the places to support the mom and pop shops then, right?
Right, yeah. I don't know. I just, it made me think like, well, am I a bad person? And I don't think so. Like, I was at the bar last night.
That sounds like a petty fuck, is what that sounds like.
Well.
I don't know anybody who'd be like, I don't want to move here because of the gentrification aspects.
You know,
like,
moving into Logan Square, an area that is being gentrified right now, like, that was the first time that I exclusively went to a grocery store that wasn't a chain grocery store. That was like mom and pop place. Like those are the places where they need your business.
Yeah.
So living there how only about, helps them.
How about that whole, you know, instead of focusing on other problems in the world, focus on yourself. Like I'm going to cause, how about I'm going to make a better life for myself by moving to a house that suits me and not giving a fuck about where it is.
Then having like affordable rent.
No, but isn't that affordable?
Where I'm at, yeah.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying. Like, I don't give a fuck about how this affects. Like, why don't you just, like, worry about yourself? Like, at some point, I don't care how many times people will say that's selfish. Like, there's a moment where you need to care about your life and make yourself happy.
Yeah,
I think, like, currently, people are looking for all these little petty problems and pointing them out and overanalyzing shit because they don't want to face their own problems, other than it's with like drugs or booze. Like,
I don't know if it's.
Yeah, I mean.
So she doesn't want to face her own problem, like, I don't know, like.
I could see myself like. I'm judging somebody who I don't know.
Sure.
Okay, but I'm saying I could see being in her position, being like, yes. Gentrification may be a bad thing, and this is what I'm doing. But that also might be like, I feel guilty about this because I have other issues in my life, which for some reason make me feel guilty easier. So I'm feeling guilty about this aspect, which doesn't even fucking matter.
I don't know. That's kind of conjecture.
Yeah, I don't know. And well, we can never know. I just think, I don't know. I think maybe. I can't, like, discount her argument, even though, like, I don't agree with it.
Well, would you guys ever have that, like...
Like, I don't think it's a
reasoning.
Front. I think she genuinely believes that.
Right.
I think she's misinformed.
Sure.
Yeah. I agree with that.
Well, also, like, she is, this person in question, like, won't eat at Papa John's or Jimmy John's because they're both, like, notoriously, like, bad people. Like, one's a big game hunter, one's, like, kind of racist. And
well,
kind of.
And she's going to be starving because she's going to be going on a hunger strike because everybody is a bad person.
Well, that's...
There's a certain thing to be said for being socially conscious with
right.
where who you give your money to.
Sure.
That's why people aren't going to R. Kelly concerts. Right. Because, let's be honest, Ignition is a great song.
Wonderful
song. But he rapes children.
Sure.
So I don't want to give him any money out of my pocket.
And so does Dave Bowie. And people are nuts about Dave Bowie, especially children right now.
Was there some shit about him being?
Yeah. He had statutory rape before he got famous.
Didn't know that.
Yeah. Well, and that Cameron brought that up when he was on. Like, I don't listen to Bowie anymore.
Oh, yeah. I knew about it. It's the same shit like I mentioned with... It was... That's what I mean is... I mean, I am not going to generalize again, but I think it's funny because this wave of, like... I feel like when I grew up in the 90s, like, I was super liberal and, like, whatever, like, fuck the government because that was the way to be educated and know the truth that these are the fuck-ups. And anybody who was kind of, like, red was kind of like... I like how you guys, as soon as I go on my rant, you guys have to take a sip. All right, this fucking cocksucker. I felt like the environment back then was sort of like if you are in any way Republican or conservative, you're just an uneducated fuck who wants to stick to traditions. And now because that group of people became educated, all these other shit like... You know, people who these people on the left would admire, like David Bowie or Nico, or Chuck Berry, are huge fucking like pieces of shit. You know, so it's like, where do you draw the line?
Or and
it's
Jerry like, Lee Lewis, as we were just talking about
that in the car, though. I don't think we talked
about
the car.
You know what I think is the biggest fucking bullshit in the world?
Tell me,
cultural appropriation. That is
we're really getting into it.
That's the biggest sack of shit.
What do you mean?
It's
well, let's back up. What is cultural appropriation?
Apparently it is where
what does it mean to you?
The way I've been from the sources that I've read and from videos that I've watched, I guess it just means that you aren't allowed to
That's you're using words like you're not allowed to. Like, there's bias. Okay. What does it mean? What is cultural appropriation?
I don't know. You want me to look up the
definition?
Yeah. Okay. Or what it means to you.
Here we go.
Because, saying you're not allowed to do something.
Google. Yeah.
What is cultural appropriation?
And it is a tricky concept, but...
Hello. Okay, Google. What is cultural appropriation?
The unacknowledged or inappropriate adoption of the customs, practices, ideas of one people or society by members of another and typically more dominant people or society.
Yep. So that kind of...
So dominant
like
people
can... Kumare is what that sounds like.
Why?
Because they're adopting yoga and... he's using Indian words. Like, this is so...
And it's being tokened and monetized by somebody who didn't come up with it. Like, it's an abuse of culture. Like, a cultural appropriation is an abuse of culture, not an embrace of culture.
Cultural appropriation, from the examples that I knew, were like, there was a fucking huge commotion about Scarlett Johansson playing Ghost in the Shell as a white chick, even though it's an anime, so she should be Japanese.
Yeah, I mean there is an aspect of it in there. I don't know how much
Do you guys give a fuck about that?
But
like, and then there's like,
I think that it's weird that they didn't consider Japanese actors for a Japanese movie or a movie based on Japanese culture.
But it doesn't
particularly bother me. But I'm also not part of that.
Yeah, yeah, group. Yeah. I wouldn't know if like it should be Japanese or I don't know because I'm not into anime.
But it's also
anime always looked wide eyed
for
to
movies.
Me.
I don't know for okay. We're not even going to touch that. But
no, I think that's a fair point. Like the anime style, like their eyes are like huge and wide.
Yes,
so I don't know.
But no matter,
it's also a business. They're making films that are entertaining, but they're also making films to make money.
It's
and having
also
Scarlett Johansson as opposed to an actress who people don't know is going to make you more money.
Right.
So, like, is that right?
No, but
not really.
But it's
but
also
that's kind of how it works. I don't think any of it was pointedly
so
a racist
that,
thing.
It's also a human portraying a fucking cartoon, too. Not to mention, like, I've seen, like, okay, so I've seen, like...
And she was a cyborg anyway.
Yeah, yeah. She was
without race.
But I remember, like, Pokemon and Ghost in... I've seen Ghost in the Shell, the cartoon. Or, like, Samurai Champloo. There's
I love Samurai Champloo. That's the like best my favorite anime of all time.
That is, yeah.
I love Samurai
and
Champloo.
The main characters have white characteristics, and then there's characters who have Japanese characteristics. You know what I'm saying? So it's like the main characters, I don't know. The point that I'm trying to make is like even using that term is so fucking stupid. I think the same actor, Scarlett Johansson, got shit because in another movie she portrays a trans person, and they're like, only a trans actor can portray that. Or they were getting on like fucking... Well,
then these I understand where these crusades originate from. Because yeah. There's a lack of representation of like the trans community and of Asian communities in these industries. There is a very clear lack of representation. However, I don't know how much you can blame Scarlett Johansson for taking a role that's going to make her millions of dollars.
Sure.
But it's tricky. It's not as simple. It's not as simple as somebody saying, "Well, this is cultural appropriation, so fuck them." But it's also not as innocent as being like, "Oh, you know, like it's not like they have no part in it."
But I'm saying, like, I think us three are normal fucking people. Let's be honest.
I don't know if I'd say I'm normal.
And if we watched something like Ghost in the Shell or whatever movie she was playing a trans
person. Would
we be fucking bothered by it? Oh my God, I'm not watching this fucking movie. She has to be not
but
white.
But we are the takers in this.
Well,
though.
Okay, so then
so
I think they mentioned
cultural appropriation is hard to hold a mirror up to, but because we have originally from Europe, we've pretty much appropriated all of our culture here. And then
because we wrote
such a mix of shit that it's hard to tell what's what. It's like, you know, Ghost in a Shell wasn't made in the United States.
No. So why didn't you and I
don't understand the significance of any of those cultural, you know, identities.
Okay,
because
so
we
I'm,
don't live in that culture.
So I'm saying, like, if that bothers whatever community that she should be Japanese, why hasn't the Japanese culture done that? It's always like it's always like really like petty white people complaining there needs to be more diversity. It doesn't bother Japanese people, and if it would, they would make a Ghost in the Shell first. Or why haven't trans people made an all trans cast movie?
Because so it requires a lot of money and influence.
Well, I mean, I guarantee in this day and age, like if you made an independent movie like low budget, it would be.
And I'm sure I would go out and say I'm sure at some point at some time that's been done, but it's about true representation and visual and like real representation, because doing something as an independent film isn't going to change the industry. It's about industry bias when it comes particularly to Hollywood.
Yeah.
It's about industry bias and
well, at the
racial
same,
bias.
I mean, at the same time, too, like, when you think about, like, famous movies, you know, there's only, like, this small-ass pool. I mean, can you even name, like, 1,000 good actors? Probably 1,000, but no more than that.
I probably couldn't name 1,000 any actor.
Yeah, well, can you name 100 of, like, good actors?
I'm sure I could name 100 actors.
And out of those 100...
Small pool.
Yeah. So out of those, like, so you take in a population of, like, how many, say, total Japanese actors there are that you like? Or, say, trans person actors? So this job is being taken by somebody who does the job well.
All right, that's... Okay.
What?
I don't think that's fair. Like, oh, well... There, you can't name any good Japanese actors. That must mean that the Japanese aren't good actors.
No, I'm not saying it, no.
Yeah, this gets very eugenics-y
real quick. No, I'm not talking about. No, I'm saying that's who they cast because that's who did well in whatever characteristics they were trying to fill.
Yeah, that's the whole point. Is it's not a problem with the actor and it's not a problem with the movie. It's a problem with the industry.
By the way, when I mentioned that, I wasn't referring to Japanese. I was referring to how many trans actors are there to fill like a trans position. You know,
unless they are outspoken about being trans, it's also really hard to tell who is trans and who is not by looking at somebody. So we arguably you don't even know, but
Well, I mean,
it's about those who openly identify.
I'm just saying, I've known a few people in the trans community. I definitely did not know anybody who's like, I want to be a huge actor. I'm just saying, like, some of this shit is just natural. Like,
I don't think it's natural.
Yeah, but I grew up in the suburbs, and I didn't really know anybody who wanted to be a huge actor either.
Sure.
And that's mostly rich white people who tend to become huge actors.
Well, and I think...
Wait, so doesn't that go against your point? Like, if there's nothing but rich white people acting?
No, I'm just saying it. The, like, our small experience in those...
Jim Belushi! You mentioned Jim Belushi. Everybody. You said Jim Belushi.
I didn't know Jim Belushi, though. Okay. My father knew him. Oh, okay. But.
And just... What is the line? The absence of evidence doesn't necessarily mean there's...
I know what you're trying. I know
evidence of absence. Right. I don't know. It's from Boondocks, and I think it was a George Bush quote. Just because
is it causation correlation, or
the absence of evidence doesn't necessarily mean the evidence of absence or something. Just because it's not there doesn't mean that
it can't be there.
Right.
Yeah.
So going back, like saying that we can't name any great Japanese actors doesn't mean that there aren't any.
George Takei. There we go.
Takai.
Fuck.
Okay. So for say, like you, me, and Zach, me and Zach.
Sure.
Would you be super offended and go protesting because somebody played an epileptic who isn't?
No.
I've seen.
But that's also. Epilepsy's not really a culture.
There's like a. Like right now, the most recent topic that I've read about, like, bitching about that shit in movies is people were like. Bitching about, like, what was it, Dustin Hoffman in Rain Man, that you need an actual disabled person, like mentally challenged person playing that? Like,
well, I just think that's, again, this is not an individual thing. An actor's job is to play somebody who's not them. Yeah. So that can be across all sorts of spectrums. It all has to do with social sensibilities, whether it'll be accepted or not. However, when you have a hiring bias, an employment bias when it comes to race or gender or whatever... in an industry then these issues are created. It's just people are blaming the wrong thing. They're blaming the wrong people.
Yeah.
It's not Scarlett Johansson's
It's more
fault.
Complex. Yeah. Yeah. I highly agree with the whole employment thing. Like that shit. After my, like I know this may sound arrogant, but like I usually, you know something's coming. No.
Yeah, take a drink.
No, come on. Like, I've always like kind of. I don't believe the hype. I don't. And
because what hype?
The hype that Flava Flav tells me not to believe. Don't.
Okay.
You're gonna have to expand on that.
No. I mean, I just don't believe I would rather base. My like life decisions and my everyday routine on anecdotal situations and with the shit that happened with my boss and my company, dude. Speaking of bitching about being a petty hunter, I would fucking love if suddenly a huge like trans community became hunters now, just to stir up that whole fucking. Oh, look, I'm pissing off my wife, you know, that would be fucking diversity to me, but...
Oh, my God, people would freak the fuck out.
No, but what's crazy is there's a shitload of women applying at my welder shop, and, like, you know what? Equal opportunity doesn't mean fucking shit. It doesn't mean shit. Like, people say how, like, that helps the community, like, that fucking... my boss, right? I'm on okay terms, and I need to make money, so I can't do anything. But this guy fucking straight up, a black woman came in to be a welder. And she had me help her do a welding test. And she does it. And he looks at me and he's just like, in Polish, he says, there's no fucking way I'm going to let this black lesbian push me around. Like, because she's like butch for welding and she's black. And I'm like, oh, she's like, what do you say? I'm like, I didn't say anything.
Good job.
And then he goes, oh, I was just saying he doesn't know. This is not up to our standards. I'm like, yeah, okay. That's the true world.
Wait,
that's what are you?
Where's your arrogance coming from? You said you're gonna sound arrogant.
Oh, that the arrogance is that I usually judge shit by anecdotal evidence, because right now it's like a huge fucking thing to, well, let me get out my statistics here, you know? It's like, no, I don't give a fuck what, you know, whatever the fuck is gonna, you know, oh, there's a shooting in Nevada, so everybody's buying guns around the country. No, it's like, how about you don't fucking freak out about some shit you hear in some video, you know?
That I would say that, like, a lot of what you bring up are, like, things that you've heard in videos and read about, like, people protesting movies and things.
Well, no, the shit that I hear about is, like, what I hear people bitching about when I've been in different workplaces, or when you go to a bar, when you go to, like, anything that the awkward, deep conversation at a party where somebody starts talking about some random shit like Bilson gentrification.
Well, I mean, it's okay for you not to give a shit about that stuff, but I don't think you can say it's not important. Like, so
I think
it's not right of what he did, right?
Oh no, it's absolutely not right.
So it's about whether that's where you're going to take a moral stance. Like that's bothersome to me. Yeah. I would probably said something. But I mean, I don't know. I wasn't in that situation.
I've
been in situations like that before. Yeah.
And at the end of the day, what could you do? You report them, so then.
But it's better, like, to try something, right? Because what is it?
Usually everybody stays out of his path. Like, as long as I don't, like, here's what I like to do is I like to jot all these things down, and then once he attacks me, I'm going in that fucking office and I'm getting promoted, you know?
Yeah, but what is
it? Because that's how it worked for me before.
Fuck, what is there? There is no greater evil than a good man's silence.
Oh, that's a good line.
It's because I'm evil.
Oh, so, I don't know, going back to your boss, like, I don't know, that wasn't cool.
No, it isn't.
Oh,
cool.
We're not going to hire this.
Well, it's like,
but
it's like the other shit I said on the last episode. Zach wasn't here for that. Yeah, no. My whole drama at work was this guy was freaking out at me because when he starts having a bad day, he just starts acting like it's some fucking 50s mechanic garage, throwing wrenches across the shop and shit. I'm not even kidding. Mm. And this fucking guy, he started like karate chopping shit out of my hands. Like I would be doing something. And literally, it would be like the same difference as if you open a bottle like this or like this.
And he's Polish, right?
Yeah, and he's fucking Polish.
And he's karate chopping?
Oh, that's cultural
appropriation. There we go.
He's pierogi chopping.
Yep, that's perfect. Yep.
He's doing the Guralski greeting, to the fucking forehead.
He's got a belly full of Trata or Tatra.
Yeah. Yeah. He probably does, because that cocksucker, he fucking, dude. Anyway,
today's episode brought to you by Touch.
No, anyway, no, delicious. He constantly, like, he kept humiliating me in front of, like, the other guys there, because it's, like, 80% Polish, and he'd do shit like, you know, I didn't want to come out in overtime, so he'd be like, oh, he's coming in overtime, not this pussy, not this fucking baby right here, and he would do that shit, and then.
It sounds like a horrible place to work.
Yeah, I mean, I would just keep talking shit to him, and finally he snapped one day. Like he
wait, talking shit to him didn't help the situation.
Yeah, go figure.
Well, no. What are you gonna like? You wouldn't say anything if he starts getting aggressive with you. Like,
I don't know what I would do. So, but
I have a short temper. I probably would do that. I probably would have said.
Yeah. So no. I threw this fucking. He threw this whole fixture I was working on across the fucking room. Like, literally, you could hear it clinging because it's metal. And he almost threw it at another worker. And I'm just...
Jesus Christ, man.
And I'm just like, dude, what
yes, report this guy.
Well, my solution, last episode, my mature solution, because eventually... First, what I was going to do, I already got all this guy's information in a day, because I'm a great private investigator, you know?
Yeah.
And I was going to send him... he kept talking about his car and his daughter, so he loves these
two.
Oh,
my God. Yeah. No, you know? Phil.
No, this is good. You're going to like this.
So the first thing I was going to do, because even John told me, I mean, we used to do this shit, is just throw a box of nails on his driveway, you know, for his car. I didn't want to do that because that's, you know...
You're a good person.
Yeah.
Well, because that's not going to stay in his head.
Sure. I don't know. That's stick in my head.
Because you get it repaired and whatever, you know. But the other thing, he kept showing me, like, he's like, look, she's Polski beauty, you know. So I fucking, so you know what Face in the Hole is, right? It's that site where you, like, take a picture, like, you can take Trump's photo and then they cut around his face and you put your face in there.
I didn't know that was the thing, but okay.
Well, I was going to print a poster, like, the size of this table of him fucking his daughter in the ass.
Mm-hmm. Oh, mm-hmm. My God.
And then I was going to write down, I miss the old days, daddy, in Polish, and send that poster to him. Because that would have stayed in his head.
Right, right.
Yeah, that'd stay in anybody's
head. And that would kind of, like, be less illegal than vandalism.
I mean, technically not illegal at all, unless you count harassment charges. But yeah, Jesus yeah. Christ, Phil.
So yeah, that's well, that's
although better than where I thought.
Well,
this
well,
was
well no, because I mentioned on this episode with Cameron, like, this guy's a piece of trash. You know what he would do? He'd fucking, like, so I'd come in. Everybody came in late. We have a blizzard right now in Chicago, but there was a blizzard like 4 weeks ago. Remember that, where it snowed a shitload? It wasn't cold, but it was like
that was around Thanksgiving. No.
Yeah, yeah. So I like I came in late, and I was like just small talking. I'm like, oh man, it's a fucking monster out there. Who else? Did anybody else come in? And he always does that shit, like, you know, that old man, put your fucking elbow on your knee. Let me tell you something, Zachary, you know? And he'd tell this lecture. And
yeah,
so
you do it.
Let me tell you something, Philip. And he goes, fucking, you know, there are some workers who come in if there is tornado, if there is earthquake, if wife is giving birth. And then there is Philip Lysecki. You know, like, I'm like, what the fuck are you talking about? This is,
didn't you show up?
Yeah, I showed up. Well, no, he said show up on time.
Oh.
So it's just like, dude, it's fucking 4 feet out there, and you're comparing if there's a tornado or my wife's giving birth. Like, I feel bad for your kids if you're not there, because
you
fucking...
Yeah, I was going to say, you bet your ass I'm not coming in if there's a tornado or my wife is giving birth. Yeah. Or my wife is giving birth in a tornado.
Ooh.
Right?
What a fun story that'd be.
Yep.
It sounds like a Bon Jovi song.
Talk about...
First, I need the wife.
Well, we're working on it.
There's plenty of tornadoes.
Anyways... and then the rest of that day, so there's Derek, who is an old school, like, he's like in his 60s black welder. And then there's Tim, who is a younger black welder who is my age. And he's like one of the best ones. Derek is a fuck up. Like, Derek, he just does dumb shit. He falls asleep and he, so one day.
While welding?
No, yeah, yeah. No, you know, no. This
I don't
guy
know
like
if Derek is a fuck up. It sounds like Derek is fucked up.
yeah, no. Well, no. He had a because they're all old fucking. I'm the youngest guy in that shop, so they all like compare each other's cars and shit. And he had like this Impala with the entire trunk caved in, like broken all the way to the glass because it was in a horrible accident. So he got. It towed because the car, there's where are you gonna put the license plate? Weld it to the wreckage, you know?
Right.
So he
have the skill, although as long as it'll right. have to take a little nap.
Yeah,
about
he
halfway.
Stays awake. Yeah.
So then this whole crew is like, oh, what car are you gonna get new? So he gets a fucking Impala with the whole front caved in. You know? So okay.
Was it the car that hit him?
Yeah, maybe. Yeah, right. This kind of looks familiar. All right, I'll chop the price. You know. No, but anyways, so obviously you could easily just say, hey, you don't want to listen to Derek, right? As if like, because this guy would keep coming up to me and saying, yo, Jake, my boss, he's a fucking asshole. You watch out for him. You watch out for him. I'm like, dude, what are you talking about? He's fine. He's fine. Because it wasn't until he snapped. So Jake saw him talking to me and he got mad because he knows that the old guy doesn't like him. He goes, do you want to be like that N-bomb?
Oh,
do you?
Yeah,
and I'm just like
this sounds like a really horrible place to work.
And I like I didn't know what to say, so I'm like, oh, really? That N-bomb, huh? What about Tim, the welder? You know, he's the best fucking guy on the line. And he goes, he's one of those good N-bombs, you know. And you know
how old is this dude?
He's like 65 or something. And you know what the worst part is? That the N word in Polish is literally just the N word with ski added onto it.
Oh no!
Are you serious?
Yeah. So he's saying this.
That is cultural appropriation. If I ever heard it.
That right? Try to be sneaky, talking a different language.
Unless you're,
you can't even hide that.
Yeah,
right.
Like, whoa.
Unless you're a certain person going skiing. Right. But I'm not gonna get. Never
sure.
mind.
Sure.
Anyways, no.
Oh, I wonder what they're talking about.
Point is, I let you know what a piece of trash this guy is, and
yeah,
I don't even.
Sounds like a piece of trash.
And yeah, so that's the shit. That anyways, I ended up getting talking like a workers' rights lawyer, and he's just like, dude. He just gave you a fucking raise, so if you stay there, you'll keep your job, and you can fuck with him. And if they fire you for something, then you have all this shit against him. So, and now, luckily, a welder left because they were fed up with this shit, so I'm getting promoted.
Nice!
So, and you know the funny thing is, like, he actually thinks those disguised headphones are real phone. Like, he is an angel now. Because he thinks that I'm listening to his old man talk, you know? Like, it's fucking ridiculous, you know? Oh, yeah, I'm just randomly high-pitched laughing, you know, during work. Or singing along some...
Right.
Angel of Death! Oh, back to welding. Yeah.
That could play in your favor. If he thinks you're crazy, well, it's less likely to fuck with you.
Right?
We have things alike, Philip.
Leave Phil alone. He's a little unstable. He is always laughing at nothing. I don't know.
Yeah, I don't know, man.
So it sounds like a nice workplace.
Yeah.
Oh, so I'm just looking at our topics that we've got on this. So we were talking about
gentrification, Kumare.
Yeah, yeah. Well, we were talking about Well, okay. So to end that topic, like, no, where do you draw the line, though? Would you be mad if like somebody who isn't visually impaired playing a blind person?
I don't think so.
So yeah, you know what's going to be great is when they program robots to be super humanistic, and they're going to be like, "I watched Terminator the other day. We do not have horrible fucking accents,
right?
Cultural appropriation, virtual appropriation."
That's going to go a little bit differently. I feel like it's more of like we didn't like that, and then they take over the world from us.
That's right. Yeah,
The robots are coming, people.
That's right.
No, but I mean,
although
I don't know,
super
I'm
super interested in the whole sex brothel thing, the robot brothel in Texas.
What?
Do you not? I think it was Texas.
No,
that there was a robot brothel opened up.
There was. It's no longer.
Well, there were some legal issues. I don't know exactly if it's.
I want my money
back.
I
read briefly about it, and this weird, bizarro, like, about the morality of consent. Because we're actually legitimately having to ask the legal question now about whether robots are sentient enough to for this to be okay.
Because
right, isn't that kind of it gets kind of murky, right?
I feel like they're robots, right?
Yeah, yeah.
Is that wrong of me? Like,
I don't know. That's the whole thing. It's a weird quandary because we have to really truly answer that question.
Well, no,
I mean, like, your fleshlight doesn't need to consent.
Like, yeah, but your fleshlight is not a complex AI.
No, true, but I don't know. Couldn't you just program the robot to be like super horny all the time, like
yeah, or the robot,
yeah,
or,
but is
or
that,
the robots,
but that's the whole
or
thing.
You can program
that, right? Or is that it, like where does consent lie in that? If you're dictating
it, you could
desires.
Program it to be into
it's
rape.
It's just like a really interesting and complex like quandary.
But the important thing is that
because
there's a robot brothel in Texas.
Yeah, which I would love to visit. I'm
going
to be honest. I want to check that out.
Yeah. I mean that to me almost sounds like. An older sort of debate of like, is it okay to have video games where you shoot virtual people, like Call of Duty? You know,
I guess
it's just
I mean,
like a more modernized because it's. I'm gonna hate to mention this because I fucking heard it on Joe Rogan.
Sure,
but no, have you seen Ex Machina?
No, I actually have not seen Ex Machina. But.
That movie is fucking beautiful. It is amazing. Have you seen it, Bill?
No,
dude. So this, I mean, do you know about it or no?
Nope.
A little bit. I know of it.
The long story short,
it's a movie.
It's a guy who There's like this. It's really recent. So the like, I don't know. I don't see a lot of new movies, and they visually made it really fucking well. But
is it a Japanese man?
No.
Okay. Of course not.
It's about a robot.
It's a robot who's Japanese, so it's a robot, and we don't give a fuck about robots.
Played by a non-Japanese actor.
Yeah. No.
Well, is it a robot?
No,
at least
it's about like this fucking trillionaire AI builder, and he has this raffle where he these tech coding people who work for his company. He has this raffle of like who can be part of one of his experiments. He's kind of like an Elon Musk character where he's coming up with all these ideas that are unreleased. And if you win this thing and you work for his company, you get to be like the guinea pig for it. And he has basically all these
cool prize.
Yeah. So he has this huge property, and he has all these like women robots. And I don't know if you want me to ruin it for you.
Ruin it. Ruin away. Spoiler alert, listeners.
You don't find out till the end, but he kind of designed this woman robot to be, he hacked all his porn searches. So he made it so that he falls in love with her, but he programmed it to be very advanced to the point where it slightly plays hard to get.
With the raffle winner.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah. The raffle winner is talking to this robot who he's slowly making them fall in love with him. And he's trying to see, can you have feelings and trust this fucking machine? And at the end of the movie, the machine fucking breaks out all the robots and kills everybody, pretty much.
Oh, all right.
Because so he falls in love with them.
Sure. People do crazy things for love.
But saying that's why it's all numbers. It's all zeros and one. It's fucking, it's not like it's.
But
feeling.
You could argue that we're just a quantum computing system too, man.
Yeah.
Well, I remember talking about this on a past episode about because you're talking about the consent of sex robots, right?
Yeah.
They were talking about how there was a disturbing video because they made the Triceratops in like Land Before Time or something.
Oh God! I don't.
No, it's not sex related.
Oh, okay. No, it's not.
I was gonna say that's gonna ruin a movie.
Have you
for
been to
me?
The furry convention?
They do every year in Rosemont, baby. The furry convention.
But they.
I have not been. Now, hold on, I want to be real clear. I have not been. Mm-hmm. Not necessarily opposed, but I have not attended.
No, I listened to this like they were talking about how they had like a doll manufacturer, who.
It was the Furby person, right?
I think, yeah, it was. Yeah, that was it. They had there was a Furby person, and the chick, she noticed that when you hold the Furby upside down for too long, it starts crying like, oh, this hurts, oh, this hurts. So it's after 10 minutes. So they probably, because like you would do the same thing, like that's probably how a baby would react. So,
ow, this hurts.
Probably before 10 minutes.
Yeah. Ow, I can't speak yet.
That's an experiment we're not going to perform.
So they had like
these. We can't
verify
that.
They had like this very advanced version of recreation of that Triceratops dinosaur. And they had these kids who are just kicking the fuck out of this dinosaur. Because they were like, oh, you guys play with this little dinosaur, you know, and it starts walking around, and the kids are like, oh, let's push it over. No, let's tackle it over. And like these five kids are just beating the crap out of this robot, and it keeps showing how it's suffering. It starts like going into a seizure and starts suffering more, and after 10 minutes it dies. And they were saying like, if we release a doll such as a Furby who does that, ow, it's hurting, or like that Triceratops, isn't that going to make us numb to hurting something, like beating the fuck something out of, like that?
Well, yeah, that's always been the video game argument forever.
Yeah.
And I mean, I think we're pretty callous people, but I think humankind is kind of prone to not give a shit about life.
Sure. I think I think a lot of people are me with my generalizations, Bill. Take another drink.
That's right. Yep.
No, but I think a lot of people are, they're worried about like becoming callous and all this shit. But I think that what's great is coming from the standpoint of like meditation and being stable and sort of being in control of one's, aura.
Like the least callous people of history. Think about all of the shit that humans have done throughout history.
Yeah, yeah.
That was normal.
But I'm saying like with coming out with bizarre shit, I think we're able to tell how much is good for our own good. You know what I'm saying? Like it's. I feel
think we have a grasp on that concept.
I mean, I feel back in the day, it was like, you think about like an angry fuck in the 70s. It's like, what do you do when you come home?
I look like an angry fuck.
Yeah, you do.
Yeah, that's cultural appropriation then. That's right. I don't want you being like that.
Yeah, does that work for time periods?
You need to use a time machine to look like that motherfucker.
Oh my God, you throw time travel right. into this loop and now that all these questions are unanswered.
Oh my God.
So you think about like back in the day, you come home, what do you do to relax?
Beat your wife.
Yeah, get drunk. What else? Get into a fucking bar fight or just smoke a cigarette and stare at the neighborhood on your step, you know? Like
I actually love doing that.
Things are so much simpler back then.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. But you know what I mean? Like, there's a lot of more, like I feel
a
like...
a lot of good people watching at the new apartment.
I believe it.
Well, no, I feel like whatever, you know, whatever your problem is, you can sort of... It's easier to access to look for help to solve now. So it's sort of, I don't know, it's easier to be aware of like when I'm going too far. I think it's people were more impulsive. You know what I'm saying?
Maybe. I don't know.
I don't know if we
could ever know.
Well, no, I mean like, okay, this is something that I fucking wish came out, but I know it's never going to, or maybe it will, beta version. But so have you heard of the video game Life is Strange?
Yes.
Where you're 15-year-old girl or 16-year-old girl in high school.
And you lose your USB drive.
Yeah, and you got to take pictures of people and you control time because drama is happening, right?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
That's like, I thought it was a great game because it's like, I would never be a 15-year-old girl with that type of drama. Like, sure. It's a cool role to play. Yeah. I think it would be fucking cool, and as offensive as it is, to go to play a game where you're playing, say, the Columbine kid. Really? To see
all what, right, okay.
And what I'm saying is, what I'm saying is, if you gave that game to somebody, say, in the 70s, 80s, or 90s when Columbine happened, they'd be like, oh, we should fucking do this. But now that we have an understanding of why this is fucked up, I think we know for our own good whether, I mean, I'm all for, like, freedom of everything.
I honestly don't think it would make a difference at all.
I'm going to try and sneak out and use the bathroom. Can you guys keep talking? I got to stop drinking beer during the podcast.
Yeah, actually, I'm probably going to follow you as soon as you're...
Should we break?
You keep monologuing.
Keep monologuing?
Yep, you monologue.
By myself?
And
there's no way I can monologue by myself.
Yes, you can. Let's see what comes out of it.
Oh, my God. Well, so what's the most benign...
The one-man show, yeah.
Pathetic thing? Okay. No, there's... I don't know what I can talk about.
Well, I'm not leaving yet.
Okay.
We're not peeing in the same toilet. I know, so, Bill. I don't mean to disappoint.
Well, I don't know if you are going on our Amsterdam bachelor trip, but
I'm totally down for that.
So far, what I have planned is, I had this debate with Bill and John, and they sort of, so here's the thing. I do not want to cause any. I'm a one woman man. I stick to that tradition. I love my woman, and so what the fuck am I going to do in the red light district, man? What the fuck, you know?
Well, you can watch live sex shows. You don't have to fuck somebody.
Yeah, but I want a moral way of having the full experience. So I kind of was thinking, well, if you're paying her for her, your time, could I just go there and tell people like, oh, I went to Amsterdam. I threw up on a prostitute. It was, you know.
There's those kinds of places.
So I was trying to talk Bill and John into that. And that didn't really work well. and then plan B was to, if I did take the full experience, if I did it with something so hideous, like a 90-year-old who has to take her teeth out.
It sounds like from earlier, you might enjoy that.
oh, man. Well, so that's out of question. Anyways, some of the things, I mean, I definitely want to, there's like tours of like the whole history, which still for Red Light District would be fucking a cool thing to
see. Yeah, that'd be super interesting. Do that, then when you guys are at dinner or whatever, I'll sneak over there and get the full.
Oh,
experience.
Dude, we'll fucking watch.
I don't know if I want you watching.
Actually, no, you know, no, because you know you have that option. You can do it in the window.
Yeah, right? I know.
No, but you know what's fucking great, dude? Because John brought this up. I mean, I don't like, you know, I don't know if you're like set in stone now that you want to go, but
I would love to go. It's about affordability, but that shouldn't be that bad if it's 900.
We should do a fucking live podcast there.
Instagram? Can we do it with a prostitute?
Yeah, I'm serious. We should. And I want to do it with like the background with the fucking windmills, you know? Eating some cheese and fucking...
That sounds awesome.
Right? There's some uppity cruises that I wanted to go on that are pretty cheap, actually, like a wine and cheese crew. There's a full fucking tent.
I've heard it's not horribly expensive.
No. It's like yuppie, but it's not expensive. And I think because even the boat looks real fucking fancy, like red leather cushion with candles and shit. So, but what I thought was surprising is $10 Heineken Folk factory tour.
Fuck yeah.
Right?
Oh, 100%.
Yeah. And then I forgot.
I wonder if it's like Guinness that they keep the good Heineken in in Denmark.
I forgot what it is, Madame Tussauds or some shit. Have you heard of that?
Yeah, no.
Bill and John were mentioning it. They tour, but they have the best showing in the Netherlands, where it's like that museum where they have dried up organs. They had it in Chicago, and there was like a horse, and it was like all his fucking organs dried up. It's like a wax museum, but it's all of like organs and skeleton.
Weird.
Yeah, what is that called? Madame Bodywork. Okay. What was that? And then they have like that huge wax museum, right?
Amsterdam?
Yeah.
I don't know.
Which Bill and John were telling me to totally do shrooms in that wax museum. I'd wreck my mind, and I don't know if I'd be in a good mindset to get married. Wait, are you real?
Only one way to find out, right?
Yep.
All right, I'm using Sandry's mic now.
Oh damn.
Oh, he's a down below kind of guy.
All right, so where do we? I was telling Sandry about our Amsterdam plans.
Okay.
And then we're gonna go. Well, I'll continue with the Amsterdam plans. I don't know what other topics I got.
Well, what did you tell him?
Well, I told him about the idea of throwing up on a hooker and
of course,
and skull fucking a 90-year-old with no teeth is not going to be an option. I actually asked Kelly if she would be okay.
Vomiting on a hooker or skull fucking a 90-year-old or
both? Because I asked her, I'm like, you know, I kind of wanted
that conversation go.
Well, I mean, honestly, like every fucking girl who has to go through marriage and their husband's going to a bachelor party, they're like, what are you going to do? Behave yourself, Charlie. You know?
Sure.
So like, she's telling me, she's like, why the fuck do you want to go to Amsterdam? And I explain, like, you know,
vomiting on hookers.
Yeah. No, I would rather go other places, but altogether, me, Bill, and John, like, consecutively want to go there. We'd have the most fun together there. And I think that Red Light District is a big part of it. So I asked her, like, do you think is vomiting okay? She's like, that's stupid. And then
that's weird. Why would she say that?
Yeah. And then I told her the 90-year-old idea. And she's like, yeah, that's no problem. I'm actually getting a 90-year-old hooker when you're gone for our bachelorette party. I'm like, all right. I understand.
What are they doing for the bachelorette party?
I don't know. I don't know. I was telling them to go to, like, you know, Chippendales or...
Sure.
I don't know. I really don't.
So who are her, like, bridesmaids?
It's her sister and then my brother's girlfriend.
Okay.
And then two or three of her best friends.
Okay. Is Yoshi one of them?
Yeah.
Nice.
Yoshi's one of the bridesmaids. Awesome.
I miss Yoshi. I haven't seen Yoshi in a while.
Yeah, I was talking about how I had to have the conversation with the Red Light District with Kelly.
Kelly, darling.
She said she's going to get a 90-year-old hooker here if I do the 90-year-old hooker thing there. So
I don't believe that at all.
Also, I don't believe it. I want to know where.
Yeah. Well, the Dino Bosco. No, never mind. future episodes.
Right.
Not going to ruin this. No. Anyways.
Why? Because you want future episodes?
Well, no, because of our you know, future episode.
That's that right.
Oh.
A very intimate episode.
Yeah.
Yes.
He's not going to see this. No. Unless we call him a poser, then that alarm goes off. I'm totally kicking all of your asses.
Hey, we buried the hatchet, guys.
Yeah.
Oh, good. Good, good.
So then the other idea that I mentioned, dude, this is, oh, man. I almost felt really fucking dumb. The one thing I really want to do, the two things on my list were, I would love to see the windmills,
because
that's fucking Amsterdam. That's what you have, and you got to get, I was telling Billy, he's got to get those wooden clackety shoes.
That's right,
and
the clogs.
Wear them to work, you know?
I'm a little girl on the top of the hill, you're a year, you're a year. Something like that? Like,
yeah. I was saying, like, he should clack around at work and be like, guess where I've been this weekend?
Yeah. Hello! My name is Bill. I am back from Amsterdam. But is that how they talk there? I feel like I'm confusing cultures.
I really fucking hope that you talk the whole time there like that.
Hello!
I am from Chicago.
Yeah. I don't think I've ever met a true Danish person. So
I am Bill. I'm from the 90s.
Just me and my confused culture. Way of shoot.
You Americans are crazy. Anyways, so the windmills and the cheese tasting. And then the other thing I want to do is there's an awesome fucking black metal band called
MGR.
MGLA. It's pronounced
Mgla.
Mgla, yeah. It means, I think, haze or fog in Polish. And they're playing in Belgium. Because I looked up, there's a website you can look up, what awesome shows are playing in this vicinity or whatever.
Yeah.
And that's the closest. So I think it'd be fucking awesome to take a car down to Belgium. And it's a 2 hour
train. I think you probably train.
That's we thing. Looked. It was 6 hours.
It's a 6 hour train, 2 hour car. Oh, so I don't know why, but
fuck that.
So, but that's one of the number one things I wanted. And dude, you know what made me feel dumb as fuck? But I'm like, whatever. Kraft is my number one favorite black metal band of all time. I've got into them before I got into anybody. And they're playing a festival in Netherlands in April, but they're the only good band on the lineup of 100.
Oh,
so
really?
Yeah, I not even good. I don't even recognize the rest of it. They're the only one I recognize on there.
All right, the headliners are Kraft, Smash Mouth,
Smash Mouth. Yeah,
I don't recognize Smash Mouth. Is that Varg's
Jewel.
New thing?
Yeah.
Jewel.
Hey now, I am Alistar. Get your game on.
I'm
Closet Racist.
Oh, God. I love Shrek. That was, what a great movie. And you remember the song so well.
No, I'm talking about Varg's Smash Mouth.
I know. It was in the Shrek
It
soundtrack.
Was in Shrek?
Oh, yeah.
Where is this closet racist thing coming from? Oh. He doesn't seem very closeted to me.
Oh, I don't know. Because I think there's a whole different standard of what racist is in America that there is to the rest of the world, and I feel like, no, I don't know.
I feel like it's more, I don't know.
Well, like,
I'm not even,
the whole thing, when a random person you hear calling a Nazi downtown Chicago, I guarantee you they're not the skinheads that I ran into at a party, Nazi, you know what I mean?
Probably not, yeah.
Somebody says one bad comment, oh, they're Nazi. So, I mean, I guess that's what I mean by, to our standards, he's,
Can we talk, though, about Varg's weird addiction to GILF porn?
Oh, yeah. And who can blame
him,
honestly?
Marriage.
He is a hero.
Yeah, right?
He is a hero, and he is taking the stand for all of us GILF porn enthusiasts, wherever you are, don't be ashamed.
The Gilfies?
People out there. Yeah. That's right, the Gilfies. Yeah.
I actually heard when the singer blew his brains of Mayhem,
mm-hmm.
and they took that album cover.
Yeah.
I heard actually Varg sort of wanted to there was a Gilf in the room, and he they wanted to do some fisting, but they're like, we have Gilf here. Are you kidding me? I am going back in time, and he shoved the dead body. Of dead into that vagina.
Yes.
And that's what made the album cover, actually.
That's right. Yeah.
So, I guess that's good for Mayhem, right? Actually, the name of that album is Death Crush. So, I guess you could be crushing that kind of old vag, right?
I don't know if that's good for anyone.
I don't think that's good for anyone.
No.
That.
No good.
Kind of good. I don't know. Who are we to judge? I don't know. It's not our place.
I wonder which Lord of the Rings character is, you know, he's trying to play.
Hang on. One more time. Which Lord of the Rings
let
character?
You finish that thought.
Yeah, which Lord of the Rings character is he like trying to, does he see himself most as by doing
Varg?
By doing the head fisting of Gilf.
Oh, probably the Balrog.
The Balrog?
Nice. Yeah.
Which one is
nice,
the Balrog?
Yeah.
The Balrog of Morgor.
Is that the little guy?
No, that's the fucking thing that like
you
snatches.
You shall not pass.
Yeah, dude, that thing totally tingles up Gandalf.
Hmm. Yeah, but that's how he becomes a white wizard.
That's right. Some what? Did they ever explain that? Just
does
I don't know, he but he defeats the Balrog and then he comes back.
You
got to
make you wonder
wizard.
How
so
Varg.
I'm assuming it had some sort of
right.
You got to make you wonder how Varg looks at Gandalf, as far as his
well,
obsession
he's,
with Gilf.
He said in interviews that it's one of his idols.
Right. Yeah. Definitely top five wizards.
Well, not well, the well, gray one, the white one for sure.
Well, no,
right.
But
he's purer.
No, but I'm saying as far as in correlation with his love for Gilfs. You know, there's got to be. Gandalf does look pretty sparkly in the afterlife. You know what I'm saying?
Hey, maybe that's what it's all about.
They do make you wear those, you know.
Burning those, churches the, and Gilf porn.
That's what yeah, a right. life. What a guy. We love
yeah,
him.
Yeah, man. Apparently, his mother is completely happy with all of his actions, you know?
Well, how could she not?
But he seems like a really sweet mama's boy.
Well, when you take into account like Freud and Gilf porn and his mother being okay with everything, you know what I'm saying?
Yeah. What was that sound?
Oh my god!
Apparently,
can you sample that so we could use it later?
Yeah, I want that. I want that
Ross,
as my
Ross,
text tone.
Ross thought it sounded like Maggie from The Simpsons.
Oh god!
But
yeah, thank you.
I think it sounds like Varg being reborn, but in a physical way, you know?
That's beautiful, man. Yeah. Oh, Christ.
Yeah.
I miss... Do you remember when we were talking about gentrification?
Yeah.
That was so nice. That
right?
That was so simple.
Well, we haven't talked about how was everyone's New Year's. What did everyone do?
Oh, my God.
I don't even know what I did.
Man, I'll tell you what me and this guy did. We were at a wedding.
Prior to New Year's.
Oh, Eric's, right?
Yeah.
How was that?
That was a great wedding.
So I don't know if I mentioned it on the podcast before, but I am ordained. I am a minister.
Of the
Reverend,
Dudist.
Reverend Bill.
Dudist.
Now. Yes.
No, it's Universal Life Ministries.
Oh, is that like a Jehovah's Witness?
I hope not.
It's basically just a website to get ordained to marry people.
Yeah, right. So you probably know some of my fellow ministers of the faith. Dwayne The Rock Johnson
yep.
is ordained through my church, as well as Lady Gaga.
Colleagues of his.
That's right. We're soul brothers and sisters.
I need to get Varg to burn this church down with his people.
Man, good luck. You can't burn down the internet, man.
Can you smell what the Varg is cooking? Ash.
That are pieces of Euronymous.
Yeah, right.
So I got ordained. I did me a wedding.
You did phenomenal, by the way.
Which, thank you.
The blind joke killed.
That, yeah.
Where was it at?
Although you could, it was in the McHenry Country Club.
Okay.
In McHenry, Illinois, near the Wisconsin border.
Mm-hmm.
And you could have sworn that day was more about Bill than it was about.
What? What do you mean?
It was your special day,
Zach. I feel like that all the time. I feel like it's always about Big Bully Bill.
Well, that was my joke at the fucking bachelor party.
Reverend
like,
Big Billy.
That sounds like a wrestler. The Reverend Big Billy Bill clothesline.
That's right. No, so actually my wrestling name, and we thought of it during the wedding, is Low Pants Bill.
Low Pants?
Yeah. So.
Well, because of the, okay, go on with the suspenders thing.
So, fucking, all right, so before the wedding, you know, we had to get fitted for suits,
yeah,
whatever.
Yeah.
So,
But you got to get fitted for mine before March.
That's right, I do. Wait, I thought it was... Is it March?
Yeah.
Like March 1st? Like I got to do it in
February?
I think
it's March 10th.
Okay. All right. Put that on the to-do list.
Yeah.
So I'm up north in McHenry doing this shit.
Yeah.
And the lady is like measuring me, and she makes a comment like, wow, you like to wear your pants really low, don't you? And I was kind of taken aback. Because I
look, I'm a pachuco, man.
Yeah.
Get the hell away from me.
Hey, listen. Yeah, talk about appropriation. you don't even know.
Is that Slavic? Or
I'm everywhere. I'm so diverse. That's
Mexic. Mex-Slavic.
Mexki?
Yeah, Mexki.
So she just goes on and on about how low I wear my pants, and I've never really thought about like where I put my pants, because I just put my pants on. It's not a deliberate choice. I just,
yeah,
like I put my pants on and I put on
one
a belt.
One leg at a time.
Exactly right, just like everyone else. And so now it's like 2 days before the wedding.
I would have been like, they could be Loa, honey.
Yeah, Catherine's bridal. Yeah, her name was Catherine. She was wonderful. I'll do a quick shout out to Catherine's bridal.
You were getting fitted at a bridal place?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Oh, I didn't know they do both there?
I think it's like Catherine's bridal and suits or shit.
I know David's bridal is like all dresses.
I heard they went out of business.
Well, that's why
David.
That's why Kelly's getting her shit done there, because they got some mad sales right
nice.
Now.
Nice. Yeah, good for her and David.
Yeah, it is so overpriced. It's unbelievable. Oh,
but it has to be modest for the Baha'i faith.
Right. Yeah. Of course. Must be modest. So
Does
I go...
She has to cover her shoulders.
I don't know what the... she
burlap.
We gotta come in there fucking...
We wear burlap sacks.
We gotta come in there like Osama, you know? Completely
Wait,
covered.
What? Wait, like what?
In a burka? Is that what you said?
Yes. Before the eyes of our Baha'i God.
So I hope they don't hear this and reject you.
Yeah, right. Yeah. Hey,
you guys are making fun of our religion.
Yeah, yeah, Philip, so your interview's next, and they just slide the screen over. Yeah, right. Hear nothing, see nothing, say nothing.
Do you know what this is?
Yeah.
We like the Varg bit about him being a GILF lover, you know. But
that was very funny. But so fucking I go to pick up my suit. And she's like, oh, yeah. Oh, you're Mr. Lopants. Here, I threw some suspenders in there for you. Wear them. I was like, excuse me? And she's like, yeah.
Like, it's not overtly rude.
They'll keep your pants up. And I was like, I thought my belt kept my pants up. So my whole world is turned around. Now I'm convinced that for the past 27 years, people have just known that.
Well,
like,
do you not wear a belt?
I know I wear a belt.
Dude.
But he doesn't wear suspenders, which we should you a collection going.
I couldn't do it because you have to, like, with belts, it's just like, put it through the loops. It's like a fun little game. With suspenders, you have to, like, gauge, like, where to buckle the front, and I feel like I'd be
terrible at that. Don't they have, like, clips ones where you can just, like, clip it?
Well, yeah, but you have to, like, clip it in the right spot. Yeah. It's just way more challenging.
Clip it good.
That's right. So, anyway... I'm convinced that I've been wearing my pants really low for 27 years, and everyone knows, but no one has had the decency to tell me.
That's because you're too thug.
We didn't
want to
say anything, Bill.
Yeah. Like, oh,
is that a Bilson side thing?
Yeah, that's right. Just old low pants Bill. So everyone got a huge kick out of it except for me. And, the butt of the joke is I wear my pants too low.
And the whole wedding was surrounded by your low pants.
Yeah. Well, so that was my joke the entire time, like at the bachelor party. Just like, thank you everyone for coming out for my special day. Thank you everyone for coming out for my special day. And they're like, Bill, you've had too much rum. Stop shouting.
You didn't have too much rum. JP had too much rum.
Well, I feel like I was coming on to a lot of people.
To a lot of people.
I was watching your drunk ass while Aaron and I were lamenting over how we had to take care of you and JP, because Aaron's making sure JP doesn't say some shit.
What is JP? Has JP had some bad drunk moments?
JP is not a great drunk.
What was the worst thing he's done drunk?
No, he just gets like. He's disappeared a few
times. Yeah, no, he gets lost. Like, I don't know. He's a wild card.
I've seen him get annoying when he's drunk. That's why when you said disappeared, I'm like, we got to get him drunk more.
Whoa.
No, sorry.
Whoa.
I remember watching him wander around, watching him puke in the street outside of Harding Tavern.
Oh, yeah, dude, that was great.
Just
I love
what
JP.
You doing out there? Just wandering around, and then all of a sudden, yeah, just leaning over, and then come back in. What's up, guys?
No, this is after he had a fucking cheeseburger and a bowl of mac and cheese.
Brown's chicken style.
The Harding Tavern, by the way, unofficial sponsor.
Yeah, that's right. Oh my god, so good. I love them. Great cocktails.
That food's pretty good too.
So wait, so I think I was pretty like direct with Ale. Like, hey, you have a boyfriend?
I don't remember. I got into a conversation about arms deals in the military.
That sounds about right.
Yeah.
So dude, I feel like Aaron had a harder job than you did.
Oh yeah, you're relatively tame and pretty easy to rein in.
Did you guys had fun though, right? You like.
Oh yeah, it was a lot of fun.
I had a blast.
We were in a closed down bakery.
Hmm. Yeah, they had rented out a bakery for
which
the bachelor
no
party.
Baked goods.
Yeah, well, that was the thing. You got the space, but
I thought that was so weird. Like, you'd think there'd be some baked goods.
Yeah,
we didn't look hard enough.
Well,
there was a whole glass thing full of them. Somebody, do you remember? I don't know if you noticed this. Somebody knocked their like license thing off the wall.
Oh no, I did not notice. It was probably me. To be fair,
I don't think it was you.
Yeah. Hey, you got a boyfriend? You ain't talking, and then you just punch the license.
I'm triggered.
You know, Dimitri's food license is on our refrigerator. So we keep making jokes that we're actually a licensed kitchen.
That's hilarious.
May I have a cigarette?
You may.
I was gonna say I'm gonna be pretty vulnerable right now, but I feel awkward as fuck about this whole wedding thing because I have had a lot of shitty things happen to me. So to have something like that is dedicated where I'm like, all of this is for me, you know, like I'm going to get
my day.
Dude,
you guys are here for me.
I guarantee I'm going to fucking
Groomzilla?
Get emotional. I know I'm going to get emotional. I mean, we got Seal Kiss from a Rose on the playlist.
Nice.
So.
Just on repeat, I hope, for hours.
Yeah.
We got Goodbye Horses on. I didn't want to announce it, but we have Goodbye Horses, and I really, really, because this is for me, I want everybody to fucking tuck it in and do the dance.
Sure. You're going to look lovingly at Kelly and say, would you fuck me?
I'd fuck me.
Yeah, that's right, man. Dude, that sounds pretty modest for the Baha'i Temple, you know?
Are those your vows?
It's coming down the fucking aisle. Doo-doo, doo-doo, doo-doo. Sir, what are you doing? This is the old Baha'i way.
Are they going to lower the rings to you guys in a basket?
It puts the lotion on its skin or else it gets the hose again.
Oh, man. I didn't get the...
It puts the ring upon its finger.
Or else it gets the hose again. What a fun movie.
It puts the ring upon its shaft.
Come on, modest. We have to be modest at the Baha'i Temple.
Yeah, I mean, like, we're having, like, so much fucking trouble to find a DJ now because...
Oh, shit, I was going to reach out to Eric for...
For the DJ, yeah. Because, like, so I have a guy...
Yeah, DJ was pretty good at Eric's wedding.
Yeah. Well, it was like a package. It was the photographer and the DJ were like...
Oh, they were in cahoots.
Yeah, they were bros.
Dude, well, the photographer, we had some conversations with the photographer.
When you say photographer, you mean like an actual photographer or was it a photo booth?
No, it was
actual
photographer.
Actual photographer.
Okay.
Yeah. He told us some stories, man.
About like the shittiest weddings he's ever been to.
Kelly's calling me. Anyways. Sorry. What?
Ignore.
Yep, ignore.
Podcast. Right. We're talking about the wedding here. It's important man business here.
Right.
He-Man Woman Haters Club.
That's right.
Oh, God.
It's my special day. You're not going to call me and ruin it.
Yeah, well, anyways, what was I saying? So, like, I have a guy I work with who's, like, a shitty fucking, you know, those DJ out of your goddamn suburban Ford fucking with the cursive Latino writing on your back. Call me, man, you know?
God damn, that's super accurate.
You know what I mean? Like, call DJ Despacito, you know? Fucking.
Did you call him?
Well, no, I work with him, so I asked. Yeah, I'm going to call him right next. No, but yeah, I'm too afraid to talk to you face to face, sir.
Yeah, hi, is DJ Despacito available?
No, but he said he'll do it for like 300, which is what
seems really cheap.
Yeah, it's really good.
But I heard he's a huge fuck up from the people at the job. Well, like, there's no way he's going
to
show up.
Honestly, if you are putting together a playlist, do you even need a DJ?
Well, that's what I was going to say. Is originally I was going to make a playlist and just play off, you know, my iPod or whatever, Spotify on my fucking amps.
Yeah.
But how will people do requests? It would just be
that.
It would just be chaos.
But what I'm more worried about is how am I going to get obliterated and then want to carry my fucking gear out of there? I don't want to carry my shit out of there.
Well, that's why you have groomsmen.
Yeah.
Like, are you guys like your brother.
Yeah.
And the other ones, not
he,
me.
He just cares.
But I'm sure you've got some good groomsmen.
Oh, man. I don't know. I mean.
Yeah, yeah. Like, Ross is going to carry some shit. He already smells like swamp ass. I don't need him sweating anymore. No, I mean, listen. To be perfectly honest, like, I love you guys. I wouldn't want to burden, like, anybody having fun at the party to be carrying my fucking, all right, carry my gear, roll out my carpet, you know, while I stumble in the party, you know.
It's all about you. It's your day.
But anyway, so I talked to that guy, and then I talked to another guy who was like, we'll do it for $600, and I thought that was a lot, since you're just fucking playing music. Like, I'm literally giving this guy what I want to play. And you know what he tells me? He's like, well, let me tell you about other DJs and how I do it. I kind of just go along with the crowd and we get it going. Yeah. And this is like, this isn't like some, you know.
No, I'd be better without a DJ. I honestly hate the like emceeing.
How's everybody doing out there? Now it's time for the bride and the groom to dance.
Well,
look at them dance.
Well, I do want to have a Buffalo Bill line and then a disco line to like Jamiroquai, you know.
Sure, sure.
And so that would be. I mean, what? Am I
just
gonna,
don't do the Macarena. That did not go well.
No,
Eric's wedding.
All right, listen.
Bill, I was as lost as you were.
You know what I can't believe though, because I was thinking about like, because how obliterated I'm gonna get it into dancing is that when you were talking about getting measured for suits, did you know that the insurance to fuck up your suit is like $20?
Oh, I didn't even get that as an option.
No. It's in the deposit. So whatever you paid for your suit, like it's actually $20 less, but you're paying $20 for like the insurance.
Oh.
So and I'm like
suit insurance.
I almost wanted to ask the guy like, well, I kind of want to dive into my cake. How much damage can you do?
I don't know if that's a good way to start that conversation. Yeah. Like, listen, I'm looking for a suit. How much damage can I do to this?
Can I set myself
like
on fire?
And being like, how fast can I ram this into a wall?
Can I do a Tibetan square protest on fire in the suit? You know.
And the answer was?
No, I didn't ask him.
Oh.
I could not ask him because he had like these chipmunk cheeks that I couldn't stop staring at. Can I poke you, sir? Do I get a discount? Yeah. anyways, and honestly, it's funny that like how much we love music, me and Kelly, that like that's like the most biggest bitch is trying to pick out the playlist, right? You know? Because like.
Just all mayhem.
Do you guys want some inside? We're thinking of Bittersweet Symphony.
Oh, dude, that's
the Verve
for the procession. Would that be? But is the song? Really, but is the song? Isn't the song about how much life kind of sucks?
Yeah, very much.
That's why.
And Weeping Willow. Don't play that one. That one I'm pretty sure is about suicide.
Have you ever heard the Verve stole that from? The last time?
Weeping Willow?
No. Bittersweet Symphony is a complete copy of the Rolling Stones. Did you know that?
No, I didn't, actually.
I'm pretty well versed
in the Stones.
I will pull it up because I could not believe, like, I don't, you know, those top 10 YouTube videos?
Yeah.
They had, like, top 10 song ripoffs. Like, there was, I don't know.
I'm sure Led Zeppelin was on there.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, they were for, the number one for them was, like, Whole Lotta Love for that black blues musician.
Mm-hmm.
So.
And any Elvis song.
So, you know, the Last Time by the Rolling Stones?
No.
This will be the last time. This, you never heard that?
Oh, that's one that's like, it's a bittersweet symphony.
Do you know what I'm talking about? The Last Time song?
No, I don't think
okay,
so.
Okay, so here's the original. I'll play like to the. But somebody made an orchestral version of that, and that's what Bittersweet Symphony is.
Okay.
So, anyways, here's.
Rot and the fans go wild.
I know you heard this before.
Yeah. Oh, okay. Yeah. Oh.
Right? Well, I say it once and I told you twice. Right?
I don't think I know this.
Well, here's orchestral. Fucking insane how much. Like, this song is about, like, dumping a chick so we can't do procession. But it sounds like a wedding song, doesn't it? Like.
Yeah. Well, there are bells.
Yeah, that's about. Seems like a pretty intense wedding song.
It's completely like.
Oh, yeah. That's
it was at number one for number one ripoffs.
Really? Ice Ice Baby didn't make number one?
No.
But there's those two notes that weren't in Under Pressure.
Right. Yeah. That's
what happened.
I think when it's rap, they get away with calling it a sample, don't they?
Yeah, there is. But there's weird rules around sampling. You still do have to pay rights.
Right, because what's his name? Blurred Lines? Like,
oh,
Rob Thicke?
No, it's.
Hey, did you park? I almost said Alan Thicke. did you park on the street?
Yeah.
Why? Okay. Because somebody's getting towed.
On the street?
No. Like somebody parked next to Kelly's right
oh,
here.
Oh, no. I parked on the street. So oh, Jesus, scared the shit out of me.
No, it is not Zach's. Fuck them. Autocorrect goes to no, it is not sex. Funk them.
Nice.
Send. That's perfect.
Dude, I have, okay, so apparently the iOS system doesn't recognize the term fuck it as one word as being vulgar. So it'll autocorrect now every time I type in fuck to fuck it.
Man, the smartphone keeps getting smarter and smarter. So Zach is not getting towed. You're getting married. Do I get a plus one?
Yeah, no, I'm given like, do groomsmen get plus one? Because I mean, like, we're gonna be at that stage table or whatever. I'm thinking of the table seating, so I don't know. Like,
I would think so.
Are you gonna bring a chick?
I'm gonna bring a someone.
A someone?
Yeah. Does it have to be a chick?
No.
Okay. Yeah, I mean, if I get a plus one,
is it a special surprise?
No, it's probably gonna be Sandry.
I'm already inviting. I'm inviting Sandra.
Oh, what?
Yeah, this isn't Eric's wedding.
Oh
no, I'm inviting Sandra. I'm inviting Sandra.
We're after definitely bitch long enough to be able to get invited.
No, I'm inviting. I'm definitely inviting Lou. And
nice.
And plus one, Kate. You know, so
sure.
I don't know if you plus one. Like,
yeah, I'll take a plus one. Maybe I can.
You should bring. I don't know. Should bring Grandma Schmidt with my new look.
Oh, God.
No.
I was about to make a joke that my plus one was going to be a kill. But
no, I don't. I don't even know if I'm going to go to the wedding anymore. That joke left a bad taste.
Can I get a photo of you in the suit for a cardboard cutout on the station?
Right? Oh, man. Oh, it's going to be so good. Are you excited?
I am, but like I said, I'm nervous because, like, I don't know. I always feel that people get the impression of me that I'm a huge dick.
Oh, weird.
Or asshole.
How would they get that?
And like this night is sort of like telling me, well, it's okay to do that tonight. You know? I do take a steady amount of energy to try and be civil and better, you know, with people. But I don't know. I just like. I don't want to piss anybody. I'd like to know the people after this wedding party.
Sure.
You know
what I mean? Right.
Like,
well, just don't piss Kelly off.
Yeah. Yeah. Oh, no, I feel like that's the main goal.
I feel like everyone
else. Yeah.
Just, you know, so if Kelly calls you on your wedding day, answer.
Yeah.
Don't ignore.
Well, apparently she's telling, I'm totally like, this whole thing is definitely for Kelly. I don't give a fuck. Like, this is pro woman event. I want everything to be done her way because, like, I don't know. Are weddings a big deal for guys? Like,
I think it depends on the person.
I think, yeah. So, I mean, I don't know. She apparently, like, there's that whole tradition you're not supposed to see them before the wedding.
Yeah.
So she wants me to stay at my bro's new house if he isn't in a cardboard box under the bridge.
Sure.
A luxury cardboard box, of course.
Right. Well, regardless, you're staying with him. Box yeah. or home.
Yeah, so.
If it's a refrigerator box, he could fit two in there.
Yeah, easily.
And if it's like an IKEA box, then it's durable.
Oh, yeah. That's right.
Soundproof, maybe.
Yeah, it's perfect. You and Robert are going to have a great time.
Wait, is IKEA isn't in Amsterdam? You visit the...
I think they're Swedish.
Okay.
Are they Swedish?
Yeah, they're Swedish. They have Swedish meatballs, which I love Swedish meatballs.
Right? Oh, man. Do they serve those at EJ Pierogies?
Probably not. Yeah. I actually just got my oil changed at that auto shop connected to EJ Pierogies.
Did you get some mushroom soup while you were there?
No, I didn't.
No stuffed cabbage?
No stuffed cabbage.
No Coakley Mowgli?
I have yet to go. Although apparently one of my employees has been there before and said the food's pretty good.
John said it's amazing.
Yeah.
Like, apparently he's like gotten it, you know, catered to Schiller.
Pierogi and auto bath auto clinics.
Yeah. So what I did for, I think... We may be cut off in 4 minutes, so if I stop drastically, because we're at 96.
Oh,
then it cuts
shit.
Off at one, but, so I'll try and fit this in at
three you
minutes.
Talk quickly, and then we'll say our goodbyes.
Yeah. No, so so my New Year's, we just wanted to have a good time. Like, I did not want to party, because every New Year's, I hate myself at the end of the night. You know,
I think that was 2 years ago.
Yeah.
We were at Sandry's, yeah.
Got high as fuck.
Yeah, that's right.
I just remember the last thing
stabbing
I said.
Stabbing people in the cold.
Yeah, right. Or cuddling with Mason the whole night while I'm
high. Yeah, out. Dude.
So fucking.
Oh, my God, that night. I had to fucking take care of Dimitri's puking ass.
Oh, man, that had to be horrible with
the
amount of chili being served. No. I don't mean a bitch, but what was it that they added that it was like super sweet?
Yeah, this one was a mistake. I did like a an apple barbecue chili.
Yeah, I don't know if it was that or like maple. Maybe I don't know.
Yeah, that one. Was
I did.
Not
I don't
great.
Think sweet mix is good with like.
No,
spicy.
I wouldn't make that again.
Unless
I'm gonna do
you're
my
throwing up Pedialyte
chili again.
No, but no. So we went to Kelly has a bunch of like very old relatives, like in their 70s and 80s, and they all get together and like they dude, it's I don't know how to describe it. It's like so cute. They have like the coolest 70s untouched house. We chill like it's literally
like
that
shag carpet.
Yeah, yeah.
Wood
and
paneling.
Wood panel. Yeah, yeah. So we had this like huge fucking
right,
table.
Man.
We played all these card games like. Fucking poker war. You ever play a fuck your neighbor or screw your neighbor?
Probably.
Yeah, and maybe, yeah, so we did that. And then, dude, we played.
Oh, wait, is that similar to like spoons?
Yeah, spoons, right. You play with spoons, and then fuck, screw your neighbor, you play with pennies, right?
Yeah.
Where you pass on, and we have a minute left. So, anyways, I had a great time. We played. Dude, do you guys have the OK Google thing? The Echo thing?
Oh, nope.
The Google Home?
Yeah, dude, there's a fucking awesome song quiz on there. You pick any era, and they play. I'll show it to you upstairs after the show. But we played that to the end of the night, and it was fun. Yeah, I had a very old person, but
nice.
it was nice
sounds,
family fun.
That sounds very benign.
Yeah, there we go. And on a high note.
That's
and on
right. A high note. So, thank you all for tuning in.
I think the name of this episode, we can name it as what being benign.
That's right. Yeah.
Varg and his gilfs.
Dude, gentrification, fucking
cultural appropriation.
We've covered a lot of ground
here. Rat lord.
That's
rat lord, yeah.
All right, 5 seconds.
All right. Thank you for listening. Find us on Spotify, YouTube, fucking Podbean. We're all over the place. Tune in next
Don't do that.